Good evening, everyone, and welcome to today's Town Hall, the first in a series that aims to share stories of tech industry pioneers from India. These Town Halls are a lead up to our flagship event, the Global Technology Summit. The summit, which is hosted in partnership with the Ministry of External Affairs, convenes industry experts, policymakers, scholars, engineers, scientists, and other stakeholders from all over the world to deliberate on tech policy issues. The theme of this year's summit is Global Meets Local. I encourage you to visit the website gts2021.com to register for the summit and to access the resources. With that, let's get started with today's town hall. Our guest today is Ajay Kaushal, co-founder and director of BillDesk, India's largest electronic payment solutions platform. For over a decade, BillDesk has been the leader in driving electronic payments and digital commerce in India. Before setting up BillDesk, Ajay has worked with SBI Capital Markets and Arthur Andersen. Ajay has studied at IIT Madras and IIM Lucknow. The focus of today's conversation with Ajay is on his journey as a co-founder of BillDesk. So the focus will be on the company called BillDesk. Ajay, welcome to the town hall.
Thank you, Suyash, and thank you for having me here.
Thank you. So let's begin at the beginning. Tell us about the founding of the company, the founding of BillDesk. How did this idea get in, come to you and other co-founders about getting into the business of electronic payments? And what inspired you and them to start the company?
So, yeah, first of all, I wanted to thank you. And we were just chatting before this. That's about 8-9 years since we met. And I think we've developed a kind of relationship where we're able to have conversations on various topics. And it is this kind of relationships that I wanted to actually highlight as part of our journey. Because, you know, entrepreneurship is a journey. It's a journey with founders. And it's a journey with the team that one starts this whole activity with. And as we were discussing earlier, I wanted to highlight 2-3 things about this journey. And I want to share with the participants and with the people present that, you know, it's a journey that I would really want to live again. It's an ongoing journey. And it's been a very, very exciting, I would say, 20 years only for us. And we've been in this together for all these 20 years. And I can share with the group here that, you know, we still sit in a single room. There are 3 of us. We all met in Arthur Andersen way back in 1999. And it was actually on the 31st December 1999 that we all left Arthur Andersen to get onto this journey of being an entrepreneur. Now, we have not looked back since then. I still have a piece of paper where my wife and I discussed, but as we start this journey, if we are not successful, how much of money do we have and can we live about a year without, with no salary coming in? So we have some of those papers. And as a set of individuals, we've all managed to be in this together. So one thing that I wanted to highlight to all of you was, you know, this journey, it's better to have 2 founders or 3 founders. I think it really helps because it's a tough journey. And if you have 2 people who are on the same side of the table or 3 maximum, I think it helps in building the confidence in making sure that people stick together. It has a bit of, you have to make it work also. So the 2-3 things that I want to point out, A, it's good to have a group of founders. B, it's good to have to be together in this whole journey so that you can have your conversations and discussions. And we, as a set of 3 founders, we all met at Arthur Andersen. And, you know, the time when we started, it was those early days of the internet when it used to be eyeballs and people wanted to get people to come onto websites. We started then. And our intention was that we should start a service which gets people back to doing transactions. And that's how we started this whole platform, saying that, you know, people need to pay bills regularly. And therefore, we should introduce a service which allows people to make payments of bills digitally. And that's where our journey began. It was also the same time when banks in India were getting onto core banking platforms.
Right.
So we looked at our service as a solution to be used on top of core banking. So core banking of banks, the internet coming is beginning to get towards transaction kind of solutions. And that's where we started saying that, look, we should have a bill payment service which can run with on these core banking platforms which the banks are creating or were creating at that point in time.
So just moving forward from the conception to building and starting a company. So you met your co-founders and you decided to take the plunge just as the millennium was coming to the end. And then you started the company, right? And what was it like to take this idea from a vague conception in your mind to actually building a company? How did you first build the team? How did you raise money for it? How did you first start marketing your services? So how did you find your first clients? And what were the challenges of just getting started at that time?
So, you know, at the time when we started, this concept of angel investors wasn't there. Yeah. But interestingly, we have two angel investors. We have two investors who we went to and we didn't have anything. We just had a small deck and we told them that, look, we are doing something. Why don't you guys put in some money? Because, you know, we were all consultants. And what we had done was we had hired a consulting firm to create a presentation for us about our product. That presentation went nowhere, but we had to pay this consulting organization and we didn't have money to pay them. And that's the time when we went looking around for angel investors. We got into angel investors very early in the journey, but whatever money we raised at that point in time, we ended up using to pay for this consulting company that we had used to pull the so-called architecture or solution together. We never used it, but then we had to pay them. So our journey begins by getting in these two angel investors. Interestingly, there was one investor who actually walked out also, who said that, look, it's not the right time for me to come in. But we had two angel investors. And then we went to, you know, ours was a bill payment service. So we had to go to some of these public sector banks because a lot of bill payments in India at that point in time were run by public sector organizations. So we went to Bank of Baroda. We had a small relationship with them because we were doing some consulting work for them when we were in Athens. So we reached out to Bank of Baroda and we also reached out to Sydney Venture Capital. And interestingly, Bank of Baroda decided and Sydney Venture decided to invest in this company. And it was one of their first investments in a startup. Bank of Baroda agreed to do it. And similarly, Sydney Venture Capital, which was a venture capital company, they also decided to come in. Our background was dealing with enterprise clients, and therefore we were able to work with these two organizations to raise some money and also start working with banks to explain the idea to them that people can make digital payments. And we still have our first presentation that we did to the banks to tell them that, you know, your customers can use this platform and make payments. So the interesting thing we did at that point in time was that we said we will not launch a service for end customers, but we would provide a platform for existing financial services players to help their customers make payments. So that was one interesting point that there was an option to do a retail service, but we thought that the amount of money required to set up a retail brand would be too much. And therefore we got onto this point of creating a B2B platform in between. The third part of this was, how do you generate revenue? Because we had started with the intention of wanting to be paid for this service. So the way we put this all together was that the party receiving the money pays for the transaction, which is the utility company. And we started paying the bank for these transactions. So the model that we created was that the receiving party pays, and the account where the account gets debited, those people earn from us. So it was a model which began to work because we didn't have to go to the bank and ask them to pay something. So three parts of the story: A, we were able to get investors. B, we were able to go and convince some of the banks and some of the utility companies to start using us. Actually, Bank of Baroda did reach out to some of them to help us get them onboarded. And three, we created a commercial model which worked for the banks and the customers of the banks, because customers didn't have to pay for this service. The bank actually earned, and the customers got a convenient service to make payments of all their bills from one place. This was the funding, the team, and the solution. Alongside, we started getting in people because we had some money now. And I just want to share that even now, for 25 to 30% of the people in BuildDesk have been with us for more than 20 years, or more than 15 years. So we've managed to keep them along. And you know, most of our clients have been with us for more than 10, 15 years in this journey.
So you basically created really new markets, new ways of doing business, and then others have followed in many ways where you have gone. And I mean, you said very interesting that many of the people who work with you today joined you 20 years ago, and not just the co-founders, also people who joined you later. So what is it about the culture of BuildDesk that people stay on for so long? How did you build this culture?
We are very open and transparent people. We haven't, the room that we sit in is all glass. We all sit together. And I think anybody in the company can approach us. That's one part. And I think the way we've engaged with them, I think we've been very, very predictable behavior. It's not that you don't hear us throwing things at people or using foul language. I don't think that has ever happened. So I think we've been conscious of the fact that, you know, we need to build the right set of relationships. We need to be working with the right set of people. And the thing about the culture in BuildDesk is that it's transparent. We let people do because it was a new thing that we started. It was not that there was a framework that existed for us to do something. And like you rightly said, the model that we created was not there, which was to pay your bill and not having to spend anything, pay it digitally, be in your own whatever, on your own computer or something and make that payment. And the participating bank earned in the process. So I think because it was a new model, we needed people who A, believed in us, because at that point in time, this whole concept of ESOP, none of those things were exciting to people. And therefore, we just needed to make sure that we got in a few people who were aligned with us. And then we were able to convince people that we were doing something interesting and new, which I think we got people interested. Along the way, I think if you talk to some of the people who've been with us, one of the things that will come back is A, it's fair, it's transparent, and it's predictable. Culture that you would find with people.
Yeah, I think it's an important insight for someone who is starting off and wants to build a business, to be fair, right, predictable, and basically also just with you, with the people who work with you. Now, yes. I mean,
I'll just add to it by saying that, you know, when people come back and saying that, what compensation or what kind of work. So we've not been very fussy about it. We made sure that they get paid in line with what the market is or somewhere there. And they have the freedom to do what they need to do. And also to create some, because, you know, in this, the other important part is to get the right people who can help you build the product. One is we understood what the market was and we were open to what changes we need to make, but we also needed a strong set of people who can deliver the solution that is required. One has the right technology or the solution behind.
Now, I mean, moving forward, so as you build the business, you got some early clients, especially with public sector banks, utility companies on two sides. You are in the middle, you built a small team, you raised some money. Now, since then, the journey has been of scaling up. It's scaled up rapidly. Last year, you processed $90 billion worth of transaction. You're the biggest payment provider, platform provider in the country. So in this journey, especially the last 15, 16 years, after the startup phase was almost, I mean, you had stabilized a little bit. What were some of the key moments you thought were important for the company move forward? You've done some acquisitions, you've changed your business model over time. You've also, in my experience, dealt with some of the policy and regulatory challenges over time, but you've kind of prevailed and moved forward. in your memory, what are the key, four or five key moments that you thought were defining for the company as far as growth and scale up were concerned?
So I would, from the business point of view, I'd mentioned 3-4 events. I think the first one was when we started with this model, initially for the first couple of years, we didn't have too many takers. Interestingly, we didn't think of shutting it either, but we continued. And it was a point in time when HDFC Bank, State Bank of India, and Citibank, in a span of maybe a couple of months, decided to use our plan. And the relevant thing was HDFC Bank used to do something on their own. Citibank, being a foreign bank and had just started doing some of these things, and State Bank was just getting into it. Because HDFC Bank started with a core banking platform, Citibank had something, and State Bank was just starting up. So it was, I think, in early 2000s that these three banks decided to use us. And after that, I don't think any bank ever did bill pay without using us. Every bank, every utility company, or any other entity which wanted to collect payments from a third-party platform used us. I think the second big shift that happened was the time when we started offering a payment service on the merchant side also. Our first service, which was bill payment, was you go to your bank, see all your bills, and make payments. The second thing that we started doing was when you go to the merchant's platform and you make a payment on the merchant's platform. So that shift also happens around 2006-2007, where we start offering a payment service. So that's the second big, I would say, and that's the second product offering that gets created. We start with bill payments. We start now offering a payment service to businesses and governments and merchants. I think the third thing happens is we are able to raise money from private equity investors. And it's that time when actually State Bank of India and one of the VC funds also decide to invest into the company. So that's the second validation of the model. And it's the first time we raised some reasonable amount of money. Because during the first time, we just raised a couple of crores of rupees. And then this is the second time when we raised some, relevant or some reasonable amount of money. Interestingly, we never used that money actually. Because we had some money, we started, and we were now beginning to generate revenue. So that the fact that a VC fund, which was actually a VC fund out of LA, decided to come in, which was Clearstone at that point in time. So that's the third big change that takes place. Still, we've not reached any scale. It's early, late 2000s, there is not so much scale, nothing much is happening. But the fact is that the model is accepted. Thereafter, I think when all these platforms like an Amazon or a Flipkart come in, and when e-commerce begins to happen, and the payment service that we have now begins to get accepted by the market, that's the big change that takes place in the system. And interestingly, not only are we working with a lot of Indian utility companies, but then slowly we are also beginning to work with all the top tier e-commerce or travel or even your financial market companies like mutual funds and insurance. So that's the time when we see a big shift in the platform. Alongside all this, A, technology needs to scale up. B, different kinds of people need to come in because the nature of the market is changing. And the last big shift is when UPI comes. As to what UPI does to digital payments, that's the big shift that happens there. And thereafter, once e-commerce picks up, UPI comes in, the whole state of the market changes. It's only now, within the last 5-6 years, then this role of policy comes in actually. To your question about how did we deal with the market. Till about, 2013-14, nothing much is happening. There is some noise about MDR or how much should we charge and all those things. But that's the time when people start to look at digital payments. I think digital payments find some interest in the government sector that digital is important and payments is important. And And that's the time when we figure out that, we need to also think about how to engage with the broader ecosystem. And I'm sure you remember, that's the time I think we first meet with somebody like you to understand as to how is the world looking at payments from the other side. So that's the journey, which has 4 or 5 events. It's getting in the right set of people, changing the technology platform, and beginning to engage with the policy ecosystem. If you see, even now, we are not a very known business. It's not that we are there in the newspaper often. I don't think we've ever given a press release. We haven't ever actually engaged a banker to raise money. We've done 3 capital raises in our journey till now, and we haven't engaged with intermediaries to raise that money. Last thing that happens, which is relevant, is we have Visa, Temasek, or other, primarily Visa coming in as one of the shareholders, given that Visa is actually the world's largest payments company. And when they come in and we decide to do some set of new things, so that's the last but one shift that happens. The last deal obviously is the acquisition, but the Visa deal is where I think there is a bigger confirmation of the kind of work that we are able to do, engage with the system and engage with, I would say, large enterprise businesses.
Yeah, it's a very interesting story. And I mean, I've seen some of these episodes, of course, along with you, but some of the older episodes before, I came to know about the company are equally interesting. But one thing is for sure that, as you rightly said, BillDesk is not a commonly known company. Some people may have seen the platform, may have clicked in for to make a payment, and for a few seconds may have seen BillDesk logo. But you're not out there. You don't do ads. You don't do press releases. I read somewhere that when you did this recent deal, it was found that you don't even have a PR company engaged to do a press release. You don't do those kind of things. You've just built value over a long period of time, and which is very different from many of these high profile founders and many of these other companies which want to put themselves out there all the time. And it's a very different game now these days. You are in a business which is highly competitive, very, very innovative. And you've remained a market leader. BillDesk has remained a market leader for more than a decade now. It's also, been making profits for many years, right? And these days we see a lot of these cash burn strategies all around us, but it's remained a market leader without using any of those strategies while making money, raising not just revenues, but also making profits. So I want to understand, you've described these episodes and they're key turning points. I want to understand, to the extent you can in a conversation, what is the secret sauce? What makes the organization adaptive, that it stays ahead of the curve for more than a decade in this highly disruptive and highly, fast changing sector? How would you describe that organizational strength that you have to stay adaptive in this space?
So, that's an interesting question. And even our shareholders have asked this question. So the response to shareholders has been, and what generates the top line? What gives us number of transactions? What gives us value of throughput on the platform? And what generates margin? Are all different. So I'll put this in perspective. See, for a payment platform, the important thing is how many transactions are you processing? Yeah. The second important thing is what's the value going through your system? Like how many rupees worth of transactions go through. The other important thing is how many transactions do you process? From a commercial perspective is what revenue are you able to generate? And the fourth thing from a value perspective is what is dropping into the bottom line. So the interesting thing on the platform is that all these 4 things the clients who generate these 4 things are different. So A, it's not easy for somebody to figure out what's happening on the platform. But we understand what's happening on the platform. And I think as a team, we understood that payments is about being a good ecosystem player. And I think you mentioned this point in the beginning. We also made sure that we were not taking away somebody's business, we were creating new revenue lines. So we created new revenue lines and we created new revenue opportunity for the other participants. So that was also a big driver of our success, that on transactions where nobody was making money, everybody started to earn something. And people who were spending money didn't end up spending that. So that was the I would say the line of thinking as we approached this whole plan. And we also understood that this is how we need to present the business to different people so that they can understand what works for them. And we knew what would work for us. So I think that's a very important part of the journey, to know, to make sure that A, you're a good ecosystem player, you're a reliable or a trustworthy partner for various organizations. And you know, you mentioned about the transaction that we did. There were so many people who we used to interact with in the late 1990s and early 2000s who sent messages to us. And those were extremely positive messages, saying that, okay, you guys have done this well and this was a great thing. And it's a fantastic outcome and all those things. But I think the interesting part was that there was not a single message that said that you guys shouldn't have done, or you guys didn't do this, or you guys messed up here. So that is the, I think we've just managed to be a positive participant. We've been able to identify new revenue streams. That was the past. Today, it's all different. Like you rightly said, today, payments is a slightly different ballgame, because earlier, you know, people paid for payments. Today, people are trying to use payments to generate customers. Right, so it's a different use case for the same transaction. We looked at payments as a revenue. Today, most participants look at payments as a cost for generating something else. And there are not too many people who want to actually, I would say, monetize the payment transaction. There are a lot of people who want to use payments to generate data about the transaction or to use it for different kinds of things. So our model was predicated on being paid for payments. Our model is predicated on the fact that if you are doing some service, you should get paid for it. And you should get paid reasonably well for it. Because everybody in the chain benefits if you get paid. And that's what got us till where we are. And while we, like you said, we were focused on the fact that it is a service, so we should get paid for it. And therefore, the company should have a reasonable revenue line and a bottom line for whatever work we were doing. But like you rightly said, today times are different. You have many, many more people who want to start up compared to early part of 2000. And there is a lot of capital available for doing these things. And therefore, you can be a little less capital efficient these days. In the times when we started, you needed to be more capital efficient. And today, you can try to create different business models using payments as a way to get customers. So times are different, but I think the fact that you need to have the right sort of relationships, you need to have the right sort of business model, I think continues to be equally important.
Yeah. I mean, as I said earlier, you built new business model, but also you've seen this as a more of a variable sum game where everybody can gain and you can grow the cake and more people can, you know, partake of it. And to the audience, watching this, all the participants, I would like to say that in 5-6 minutes, we'll be taking questions. And wherever you're watching, whether it's on the Summit platform, YouTube, or Twitter, please feel free to put your questions and I'll read them out to Ajay for him to answer. Now, one more question I had is that, and this is something related to what we spoke about when we were having a call some time back, is that definition of success. So BillDesk is a highly valued company. Regulatory approval is pending, but you've been able to, the company has been sold for $4.7 billion. So a lot of value being generated over about 20 years period. So this is, of course, this amazing valuation is one definition of success. But looking back into journey of these 21 years, how do you define success as an entrepreneur, as a founder of this company?
So, you know, even now, if we pick up the phone and call somebody, I think that guy will pick up the phone and will help us. There are, like I said, there are almost 150 people in BuildDesk who've been with us for 15 years. There have been clients with us who have not used the second payment provider till now. While now there are many people who use more than one payment provider. But the fact is that there are so many people who've trusted us for, I would say, so many years. So I think some of these things, apart from the fact that, you know, in today's day and age, the only metric of success is value. But keeping that aside, I think the journey, the relationships that we built along the way, I'll also share with you that, you know, one of the bankers that we met very, very earlier on in the journey, over the next 15, 20 years, we kept meeting with that gentleman and to be in touch with him and get feedback from him. Whenever one would meet with him, he would have three questions for me. He knew my wife, so he'd ask me, how's your wife? Second, he would ask me, how are the three of you together? And the third question he'd ask me is, do you pay dividend? And over the 15, 20 years that I used to meet the gentleman, these three questions were always asked. So I think it gave the gentleman a very good idea of what was happening. If the three of us are together, that means there is order. If the equation with the wife is fine, I think things are fine at home. And lastly, if the company is paying a dividend, that means there is something falling onto the bottom line. So I think it is some of these, I would say, relationships, the events that have happened over all these years. And I think the positive feedback that we got post the transaction announcement, I think some of these things have been equally, if not more, heartening than the commercial outcome of the business.
So what's next for you now? I mean, of course, you're still at BuildDesk, you're working, running the company, but what's next in the next few years? What are you thinking of doing?
So, you know, we haven't actually sold all the things that we were doing. So we continue to run two of our subsidiary companies that we had, one is Jukata, which is into analytics as well as digital platform for digital lending for NBFCs and banks. We also own a company called Loyalty Rewards, which does work around all these points and other things. And we also own another company, which we were looking to do some. We actually started doing something on the crypto side earlier, but we didn't continue given the situation. So one is we need to make sure that how we grow these businesses. I think as a set of three people, we are looking to start something which is around I would say more in the arena of a blockchain platform or a DAO or some of those things to see where that takes us. And the third is we need to make sure wealth that we create, we are able to put it out to good use, whether it's working with academic institutions or working with some of the philanthropic organizations. So there is some plan that we have around it. To use whatever we can in a way that it helps people, it helps entrepreneurs, or it helps create more opportunity for people. So those are the three, four broad bucket of things that we are looking to do.
Great. One final question from me before we segue to Q&A is, if someone wants to do a fintech startup in India, what do you think, what would be your advice to them? I mean, broadly what should they expect and how should they approach it at a personal level? Like what would be your advice?
So, you know, I think there is a humongous opportunity. Almost all of financial services, almost all of banking and all of these systems, and most of them are more than 25 years old. So if somebody can and has the patience to build something which is more today, which is more, I would say, designed for an environment. See, because most of these systems are not designed to work with data, to use data. They're designed to be in silos. and most of the banking system, insurance platforms, mutual funds, they are of that kind. So I think there is a big opportunity to think of what to do in this big fintech ecosystem, whether it is wealth or any of those things. There is also a big opportunity to streamline access to these products and services. And there are so many people who are trying to do that kind of work. But I think there is a lot of value to be got in this whole plumbing ecosystem. While people are trying to make access simpler by coming up with better looking apps and better user experience and great interfaces. But I think if somebody did the hard work of working on this plumbing, I think there is a big opportunity that can be unearthed in working on the plumbing, getting some of these things right, and making something which can be better used going forward. So from a technology perspective, as far as offering services to end customers and some of those things are concerned, there are a lot of people who are trying to build products, whether to embed lending or to embed insurance or to make wealth management simpler and those things. So there is a lot of work happening, I think, on the front end side. But to do something on the back end, under the hood, I think there is a big opportunity, and it will have very sustained value. Because, today, if you take a country like India, for somebody to get 50 to 100 million customers, there are so many people who have this. But I think if you fixed the stuff under the hood, it's not exciting stuff. It doesn't get you advertising. It doesn't get you your name in the newspaper. But I think you can create more long-term and sustainable value as an outcome of doing something under the hood.
That's great advice. So we have one or two audience questions. And if other participants want to ask any questions, please feel free to enter them in the Summit platform, YouTube, Twitter, wherever you're watching this. So one question that we have is with respect to RBI's fresh rules on mandates for recurring card payments, has that impacted the business at BillDesk? It's an audience question.
Okay, interesting one. So, BillDesk, we created a solution to solve this problem called SI Hub. So from the perspective of the solution and the fact that a large number of people are using it helps us. But on the payment side, we have seen a lot of people, transactions not getting processed or people not being able to get their recurring transactions going. So that obviously causes a lot of stress on the platform and stress with customers and businesses that we work with. But we've been working quite hard with all the participants to make sure that the impact of the e-mandate guidelines on end customers is minimized. But I also want to add that what this gets customers is also very interesting, that they will be able to see all their recurring payments on a common platform, which has not happened in India ever. And it's not happened in any other part of the world also. Because going forward, customers who've set up recurring payment instructional cards will be able to go to their bank and also start, stop, or modify these instructions. I also want to just share with you that it is only now, I think about a couple of months ago, a law was passed in California that in the US, all these, you have a lot of these platforms where you can start a subscription, but stopping it is very difficult. So it starts with a click, end with a call. Mm. Okay, so that's the model there. And so I believe there is now a ruling from the Federal Telecom Commission or FTC that this has to stop. But here in India, we've already solved for the problem. And I think the outcome of this, while there is some bit of stress currently, which one should get over with, but I think the positive outcome is that everybody will be able to see all the recurring payment instructions in one place and would be able to manage, modify, or do whatever they want to do from their bank's platforms also.
Thanks. Another question from audience is, BillDesk has had many potential buyers. How did you decide what offers to take up? Why did you say yes to the deal with Prosus? What made you finally close the deal?
So, you know, it was earlier this year, we were actually on our plan to get listed. Like I said, in 2018 or 19 is when visa came in, and we had almost, I would say, three or four top tier shareholders as part of our cap table. We had top tier venture fund as part of the cap table. And our plan was to now get listed because, you know, we are a 20-year-old business. It's like you said, it's been generating profits and a reasonable amount of revenue. So our plan was to get listed, but then the team from Prosus approached us, and I think one of the things about the Prosus transaction the deal was that, you know, Prosus has a larger financial services mandate, and given the kind of change that is taking place and the kind of opportunity that one needs, I think to have a larger financial services mandate, which includes credit and some of those things, is also important going forward. And so the idea was either we build it ourselves or we work with somebody who's in that same direction. And in addition to that, so we were on the path to an IPO. This offer comes down, we have a conversation, and interestingly, it all fructifies and we have a deal. I can ask you a question while you're looking at questions.
Yeah, please.
How do you look at this sector from the outside? You're quite close to at least some of the policy things that have been happening. And how do you look at those?
No, I share your sentiment about the enormous potential that is there. And I also look at the data on productivity of traditional firms in India. And we have relatively low productivity in, for example, banks. The amount of money that they take to do the financial intermediation is higher than in other countries. So they're ripe for disruption. But I think there are some bottlenecks. For example, the fact that you have public sector banks that dominate the banking landscape, although they obviously accept and enable a lot of innovation that helps their business. But when the innovation which actually may disrupt their fundamental business model may come along, it will not be easy to push that kind of innovation, especially given our political economy, where ultimately the government will have to take the hit because it owns those banks. So there are bottlenecks which are much harder to get through than what we have seen till now. So going forward, if you had a traditional models were run mainly by private firms, you would see creative destruction and government may not be worried too much. There will be some transitional issues. There will have to be bankruptcy resolutions will happen, all of that. But that the traditional models are largely owned by government itself creates a new kind of political economy challenge in the long run, not in the short to medium term. Many businesses can be built, a lot of value can be unlocked. But in the long run, we need to address this problem. And the other side is that as disruption happens, more and more firms fail or fail to adapt. They will have to be resolved in an orderly manner, and we don't have a good system to do that as of now, at least on the financial side. On the non-financial firms, we have a system now. So we'll see how that goes. So my view is that we need to adapt the policy and regulatory landscape to be able to deal with these changes that are going to come to us, or we will end up slowing down the progress that we should be seeing otherwise.
Yep.
So I think we are out of time. Thank you so much, Ajay, for taking time to talk to us. And it's always a pleasure to talk to you. And I've long been an admirer of the way you've built your company and run it, and the kind of ethics that you brought to it. I'm very happy when you were able to, you know, in a way, get these different series of validations for what you have done. And the latest being, of course, this deal that you have closed. So thank you so much. And thank you for your insights. And thank you to the viewers for joining us today. Please be sure to register for the Global Technology Summit, which will focus on contemporary tech challenges, such as data transfers, supply chains, and questions around artificial intelligence and so forth. And of course, issues of fintech, which we discussed briefly with Ajay today. You can register for the Global Technology Summit by visiting our website, gts2021.com. I repeat, gts2021.com. Thank you.
Thank you, Suresh. And thank you, everybody.